is the holy day of the birth of Swami Shivanandaji Maharaj, very dearly called as Mahapurush Maharaj. He was the second president of our order. He was the president from 1922 to 1934 for full 12 years. Earlier to him, Swami Brahmanandaji was the first president. He was for 25 years, 1897 to 1922. So next to him, among the direct disciples, he was for the longest period of 12 years as the president. So he was called Mahapurush by Swami Vivekananda himself, who used to say, even during his days in Belur Math in 1920s and 30s, he told once to Swami Brahmananji, "I see Sri Ramakrishna always here in the Belur Math, so that is why I am able to live happily in this Belur Math." Though Sri Ramakrishna was not in the physical body, he says, I see him every day, that is why I live happily in this mutt. Like an innocent child, he could express all his spiritual experiences to even common people also. That is how so much of his spiritual experiences are on record. They have almost become an encyclopedia for all spiritual seekers. He always glorified the name of Sri Ramakrishna as the Taraka Mantra for this age. So during the last part of his presidentship, he would always say, "I give only Ramakrishna Mantra." Earlier he might have given the mantras of different aspects of God, but during the last period of his life, he used to say, "I don't see any other greater mantra than Sri Ramakrishna's name. So whoever comes to me, I give them only that mantra." He used to say, "Name of Sri Ramakrishna is the Taraka Mantra of this age." That means Taraka Mantra is that which takes you across the ocean of life, which will give you freedom from all bondages, which will give you moksha. So that is called the Taraka Mantra. He called Sri Ramakrishna's name as the Taraka Mantra for this age. So he used to say, "I always repeat the name of Sri Ramakrishna and am merged in the joy of it. Even if you cut off my tongue, I will go on repeating his name through my mind." In fact, during his last 10 months, he went into a fit, epileptic fit. He had a partial paralysis on right side and he could not speak. But then he was always repeating the name of God mentally, merged in always in joy. "I don't feel at all I have a body," he used to say. Such was the high state in which he lived before he left his body. One Swami Vishwarupananji, who was his disciple, so he was in charge of, he was working in one of our hospitals in Banaras. In Kashi, we have got a hospital where we Swamis ourselves, we work as nurses, we work as doctors, we work as other departmental people also. So Swami Vishwarupananji, disciple of Swami Shivanandaji, he wanted to work in the laboratory there in the hospital. So from Kashi, he came to Calcutta when Mahapurush Maharaj was the president. When he came and took training in clinical work, then after took his clinical training, then Swami Shivananji asked him, "Why have you taken this training?" He said, "You see, I have to work in the clinic. That's what the hospital administration, our Swamiji in charge of the hospital in Banaras has told me. That is why I have learned this one." "Are you going to work in our clinic?" So Mahapurushna did not believe at all that he will work in the clinic. What happened? The Swami returned after training. And then when he went, the pujari, the Swami was doing the puja of Sri Ramakrishna in the shrine. I think something happened to him. he gave up the puja. Somebody else was required. So he was never put into clinical work. He was put into the hospital, to the puja work, which he did for 24 years. Went on 24 years and it was a simple puja work. And the Swami was very highly intelligent. So apart from the puja, he would take very little rest and then move to all the great pandits in Banaras and went on learning the Vedanta, the different Upanishads and Brahma Sutra from almost all the living top pandits of Vedanta. And he compiled a book of what he had learnt from Dvaita, Vishishta Dvaita and Advaita schools from different scholars in Banaras. And after 24 years, he produced a book called Vedanta Darshana in Bengali. Then the press people, they said, we have never heard in the last 100 years, nobody has taken 24 years to produce a book like this, especially on a subject like Vedanta. So that book is there even now. It is published through our Udbodhan, a monumental work. So this, how Mahapurusha Maharaj could say, are you going to work in the hospital? So he himself did not know. The head of the department, hospital did not know. But Mahapurusha was aware of all past, present and future. He was a Trikalajna. So similarly, it happened to the president of the Sharda Mutt, the first president of the Sharda Mutt, Prabhurajika Bharati Prana. She was serving Holy Mother. She was called Sarala Goshal. So she served Holy Mother with great devotion, and Holy Mother had advised her. She had several spiritual experiences also during the time of Holy Mother and afterwards also. When Holy Mother passed away in 20, then Sharat Maharaj, Swami Sharadananji, who was taking care of this Sarala Goshal, so he suggested, now you are serving Holy Mother. Holy Mother is no more in this world. So why not you go and serve the other mothers in the old women hospital we are running in Banaras, so you can go and serve them. She also agreed. So all right, I am ready, I will go and serve the old women, people of old age who are there admitted into one section of our hospital, even though it is there. Our devotees from Chennai also are there now there. So she offered, all right, I can go. Everything was settled. Then she went to Mahapurusha Maharaj, who was the president, to salute him. And he asked, what are you going to do? She said, I am going to Banaras. Sharat Maharaj is sending me to serve in the old age home there. Are you going to serve in old age home? Your work is finished. All the work that you had to do is all finished. So you now only go and take the name of God. You do tapasya there, you don't do any work. Mahapurusha Maharaj's advice. So she said, all right. She agreed with Maharaj, went and took a small place, and she did tapasya for 35 years. And after 35 years, she was called back, and she had to become the first president of the Sharda Mutt, which was formed in 1954. She became the first president. How Swami Shivananji could know? She has agreed, Sharat Maharaj has told, everything is settled. But Mahapurusha Maharaj, he knows, you are not going to, your work is all over, no? You have only to do tapasya only, calling the name of God, that is the only thing remaining. You do that. And she was prepared. And she was the fittest person to become the first president of the Sharda Mutt, which is a worldwide nunnery, so nuns organization. So like this, Swami Mahapurusha Maharaj was an extraordinary person, but with a very most humble outward appearance. Anybody who would see him could never recognize that he was such an exalted person. Swami Vivekananda himself, once while discussing that our Sri Ramakrishna was the great person, but conquered lust, Kama Jayi. He was a Kama Jayi. He had conquered lust entirely. Then Mahapurusha Maharaj said, by his grace, I have also conquered lust. When Swamiji heard about this, Then Swamiji immediately said, then you are a Mahapurusha. That is how his name became Mahapurusha. So Swami Shivananji is known in our order as Mahapurusha Maharaj. Mahapurusha is a great soul. So already they are all great. Among them he is great. So such was the exalted spiritual level of Swami Shivanandaji. And Swami Shivananji was born on a Thursday, 16th November 1854. That means he was almost 8 years senior to Swami Vivekananda. And his name was Taraknath. His mother was Vama Sundari and father Ram Kanai Ghoshal. So Ram Kanai Ghoshal was a pleader, a sort of a lawyer. So he used to do legal work with some jamindar. And he was a well-placed person in society. And this child was born to Vama Sundari after two daughters. It is said that she prayed for a son. Then the Tarkeshwar Shiva of the Tarkeshwar Tirtha, he appeared and then told her, so you will get a son, I will be born as a son. So, and she got this son. That's why he was named Taraknath. He became Taraknath Ghoshal. Then from there, he became, Sri Ramakrishna used to call him Tarak Tarak. All the other disciples used to call Tarak Da. Tarak Da is Anna. Tarak Anna they used to call. And then he became the famous Swami Shivanandaji Mahapurush Maharaj. So when he was born as a child, from the very young age, he had a great meditative tendency. The astrologer saw his horoscope and then told him, at his 25th or 26th year, he is going to become a monk. If he does not become a monk, he will be living in great luxury like a wealthy man. Either this will happen when he becomes 25 or 26 years. It exactly happened. He comes to Sri Ramakrishna in 1880. In 1854, 26th year, he comes to Sri Ramakrishna and lives with him. And he became a monk. So in those days, astrologers also were so powerful. Everything was strong because they were all true people. So people who are truthful, whatever they say becomes true. So then one after another, lot of bereavements were there in his family. He lost his mother when he was 3 years old. Then his father married for the second time. And his elder sister became a widow. So another elder sister, something happened to her. So all sorts of miseries befell him. So his mind turned inward. So he left his education when he was at the intermediate level. Then he sought an employment in the railways. He got one employment at Ghaziabad, where earlier also some direct disciples also were there near Mughal Sarai. So he was working there in the railway department. There he spent much of his time in meditation and prayer, and he had to pray every day to Sri Ram, to God, to show him the path to Samadhi. Samadhi means the highest bliss in spiritual life. In the meanwhile, according to customs in those days, he was married to one Nityakali, and that was also to help some other one. It was sort of a marriage in exchange. He would marry the daughter from that family, then one son he would marry, and they would marry the son from this family, like that. To help his younger daughter get married, he got this marriage done. Then he came to hear about Sri Ramakrishna through one of his friends named Prasanna. He told, you are talking so much about Samadhi, you are desirous of knowing about Samadhi, why don't you go to Dakshineshwar? There is a Paramahamsa there. When he heard about it, he became very eager to learn Samadhi from the Dakshineshwar Paramahamsa. So he tried hard and got a job in Calcutta itself. So he came over to a British company, Mackinnon Mackenzie. So he settled down in Calcutta, started visiting Sri Ramakrishna. So as I already said, when he was 26 years old, that is 1880, he met first time Sri Ramakrishna in Ramchandra Datta's house in Calcutta. There, he wanted to know about Samadhi. Sri Ramakrishna was merged in Samadhi when he went. When he first went, he found Sri Ramakrishna is completely lost in spiritual ecstasy. That is Samadhi. Then he comes down from that ecstatic state and starts talking about Samadhi. What Samadhi is, how one can attain to that one, what are all the preparations to be done, how we have to purify and concentrate our mind on God. All these things Sri Ramakrishna started talking. That was what he wanted to know. In the very first meeting, without even asking, Sri Ramakrishna conveyed all the message to him. Then after a month, he went for the second time. Then he found Sri Ramakrishna was sitting on the floor with the other youngsters there. Then Tarak saluted Sri Ramakrishna, and Sri Ramakrishna took his head on his lap like a mother, and Tarak felt that he is laying his head on his mother's lap. He felt at that time that Sri Ramakrishna is my mother. He is full of compassion like a mother to a child. So from that time onwards, he had that feeling. He used to think Sri Ramakrishna as his mother and would be very free with him. Then Sri Ramakrishna asked him, "You stay overnight here." Then Tarak said, no, I have promised another one friend that I will meet him tomorrow, so I must go today." Then immediately Sri Ramakrishna said, "Yes, if you have promised, you must keep up your promise, because truthfulness is the tapasya for the Kali Yuga. In Kali Yuga, you don't have to do big tapasya, going to forest or doing homa or yajna or offering all the wealth to others. The greatest tapasya in Kali Yuga is to be truthful. Tell always truth, be truthful, that itself is the greatest tapasya." So he advised him in the beginning days, truthfulness is the tapasya of Kali Yuga, you keep up truthfulness. Then one day Tarak had gone there to Dakshineshwar, so he spent the night there. So it was midnight, suddenly he found Sri Ramakrishna has got up in the midnight. So all the place is so silent. Dakshineshwar in those times, it was a completely jungle, cut off from the main road also. So in that dead of night, Sri Ramakrishna has got up in his room, and then he is singing the name of Rama, Ramnam. So Ramnam he was singing, he went and awoke all these one or two people who were sleeping. "Are you sleeping? Get up, let us all sing Ramnam." They all started singing, and the singing did not stop the whole night. From 12 o'clock up to sunrise, it went on. So he said, then he used to say, "You see, you come here, you don't come here to sleep. You come here only to take the name of God and purify yourself." So this is how his spiritual career started with Sri Ramakrishna. One day Sri Ramakrishna touched him on his chest. Immediately he went into deep ecstasy, and he realized in that ecstatic state that I am the spirit, I am the Atman, I am different from my body, and master is the Paramatma. Paramatma is in and through all the Atman, so we are all Jivatmas. So Swami Shivananji Tarak, at the very first touch of Sri Ramakrishna, he realized this truth, that he is the pure Jivatma, different from body and mind, which is eternal. Mamaivamsho Jivaloke Jivabhuta Sanatanaha. Bhagavan Sri Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, "I am the Jivatma in every body. Jivatma is part and parcel of me. Mama eva amshaha." The Jivatma is part and parcel of me. So Jivatma and Paramatma are always one. They cannot be separated. So that truth by one touch, Sri Ramakrishna imparted this one. So he realized on that day that I am the Jivatman, pure as God Himself. And all of us are Jivatma, every being, we are all part and parcel of the infinite God, Paramatma. Paramatma is through and through us, and we are in Sri Paramatma. This, afterwards he went and told Sri Ramakrishna, I experienced like this. Sri Ramakrishna said, correct, you have realized the real truth. Then Tariknath one day went and asked for Bhava Samadhi. Bhava Samadhi means experience of God in a particular form, in the form of Shiva or Narayana or Shakti. So, but Sri Ramakrishna said, no, you will not have Bhava Samadhi, you will have formless meditation. Now you will realize God in His formless aspect, maybe like infinite light or infinite space. So you will have formless experience of God. Later on the form will come. Usually people say you go through form to formless, usual process. But Sri Ramakrishna told him, no, you will have formless experience first. Afterwards you will have formful. In case of Swamiji also it happened like that. He was a worshipper of formless God. Then he came down to worship Kali and all Krishna and all the devatas. He realized. So Shivananji's case also, he started with formless meditation. Then later on came down to form, meditations with form. Then Sri Ramakrishna told him, don't be impatient. Mother will give you all. And then he wrote some mantra on his tongue. Immediately he got the experience of God with form also. So Sri Ramakrishna was such a master, guru. So Sri Ramakrishna one day tells Tarak, many white complexion devotees will come here. In 1881-82 he is telling, which is going to happen. Now we see how many white people are coming here. For every ashrama here, outside ashrama, wherever you go, white people are more earnest and they are coming seeking spiritual message and spiritual experience in India. Whereas we are running behind material things in their country, they are coming here seeking spirituality and spiritual experience. So Sri Ramakrishna had this truth with him. He conveyed this truth. Many white complexion devotees will come here. Then in the meanwhile, he was very much worried. He told Sri Ramakrishna about his worries about his wife. I am married, I have to take care of her also, and I cannot come here. Then Sri Ramakrishna consoled him, don't worry, mother will arrange for everything, wait. So he continued with his job. He used to come regularly to Sri Ramakrishna. And then in 1883, after 3 years of his coming to Sri Ramakrishna, for some reason, Nityakali, she passes away. She was a very good wife. So she cooperated with him in all his spiritual sadhana. From the very beginning, he had told her, you see, our goal is to realize God. So we cannot live like husband and wife. She had cooperated with him. And then afterwards, she left the world itself and went away. So he became very free. When Sri Ramakrishna got the cancer in 1886, during that state, Sri Ramakrishna got 12 pieces of saffron cloth. One Gopal, his disciple, Budo Gopal, Gopal the elder. So he brought 12 pieces of saffron cloth to be given to some sannyasis. Sri Ramakrishna said, where can you get a better sannyasi than the youngsters who come here, like Narendra, Rakal, Itya Niranjan, and all these. So one of the saffron pieces was given by Sri Ramakrishna himself to Tarak. That is how from that day itself he considered he was a sannyasin. Then when Sri Ramakrishna was alive, Tarak went to Bodh Gaya along with Narendranath. So both were doing meditation there. At that time, Narendranath later on told, I saw a great light of Buddha entering into Mahapurusha Maharaj, Narendra, Tarak. So afterwards, Swamiji was so pleased, he went and embraced him. And they came back and told their experiences. And then found, they said, nothing is there in Bodh Gaya except this spiritual experiences we had. Outside there is nothing, everything has become dull and drab. Then Sri Ramakrishna remarked, this time everything is here, nowhere else. Because wherever God incarnates, there will be solidified spiritual atmosphere. You don't have to struggle there. Just to enter, you will feel the difference. So Sri Ramakrishna said, this time everything is here, nowhere else. Then Sri Ramakrishna, in 1886, August 16th, he went away to his own abode in Mahasamadhi. Then after some time, all the direct disciples, they took sannyas, and Taraknath became Swami Shivananda. Sri Ramakrishna, when they have become sannyasis, they want a monastery. So they found out a haunted house at Varahanagara, Baranagar. So at Baranagar, there was a haunted house for which they would pay 10 rupees rent, because nobody would go there. Who will go and live with ghosts? So these fellows, all the 12 disciples went there, occupied that house and paid 10 rupees also. And they were going without food or without drink. They were struggling. Then Sri Ramakrishna appeared before one of his household disciples, Surendra Mitra. And he told him, Sri Ramakrishna has appeared in a vision. And he is telling him, you see, Baranagar, my boys are all going without any food. And you are here comfortably sitting in your house. Go and immediately help. That is how Surendra went and promised them, whatever he was spending on Sri Ramakrishna when he was alive, I will give that money, so you can employ one cook and you can live a simple life here. And so he started giving them 200 or 300 rupees every month. That is how the first mutt, Ramakrishna mutt, was formed in Varahanagara. There in that Varahanagara, all work had to be done by these young people only. There was no other servant except a cook. Therefore, all the hard work of rubbing the vessels or cleaning the whole yard and dusting the whole big dilapidated building and keeping the shrine shining, all this hard work was taken up by Mahapurusha Maharaj, Shivananji. He used to do, and also he would go on pilgrimages. He went to Almora. There he found one businessman, Lala Badri Shah, very good spiritual person. And later on he became a great devotee of Swami Vivekananda and the whole mission. So he became his great devoted person. And he also met one theosophist, E.T. Sturdy. He was an Englishman. He was trying to do theosophists, you know, they were preaching Hinduism in their own way. So he was influenced by the theosophist Hinduism. So he was living like a sannyasin in Almora, going to the chhatra, the chowltry, and taking bhiksha, alms from there, and then living like a sannyasi. Then when he found Shivananji there, he was deeply impressed. Afterwards, when he went away to London, he was always thinking about Shivananji. When Swami Vivekananda goes there, then he becomes a great admirer of Swami Vivekananda and becomes his disciple later on. So E.T. Sturdy was there. So during his pilgrimages, Swami Shivananji came to South also. He came to Kanchipuram, he visited Kanchipuram, Madras. He came first to Madras, from Madras, Kanchipuram, Chidambaram, Madurai, Rameshwaram, Bangalore, Srirangam, all these places he visited. That is much before, in 1893, just Swamiji had left for the West and he had come at that time. Then he goes to Varanasi. All great spiritual giants were living there at that time, like Trailanga Swami, Bhaskareshwarananda, Bhaskarananda, then Chameli Puri. They all met Holy Mother also. Sri Ramakrishna had also met Trailanga Swami. And Swamiji also met all these people. So Taraknath also met all of them. And then he had the blessings from all of them. Then so he came down in 1897, after 4 years again, to South to join Swami Vivekananda in his visit to Chennai. So he joined him at Madurai and he arrived in Madras along with Swami Vivekananda. He was there, Niranjananji was there with him, and Mr. and Mrs. Captain and Mrs. Saviors were there with Swami Vivekananda, and Goodwin was there. So that party came here and stayed in our Vivekananda Illam in 1897 February. And then afterwards he returned to Calcutta along with Swami Vivekananda. Then Swami Vivekananda left for Almora. Along with him he took Shivananji also. And afterwards Swami Vivekananda asked him, "You please go to Sri Lanka and then preach there." So taking the orders of Swami Vivekananda, he went to Sri Lanka. For full 10 months he stayed there in 1897-98 and preached Vedanta. There, the first Australian to hear about Vedanta was one Mrs. Pickett. She learnt Vedanta from him. She went to Australia and started a center of Vedanta center. So in 1897, now only we opened our Australian center about 10 years back in Sydney. One center had already come up there, Vedanta Center, through the influence of Taraknath, Swami Shivananji. Then he trained one Mrs. Pickett to teach Vedanta in Australia and New Zealand. And another time Swami Vivekananda said to Swami Shivananda, "You see the power of this place will... See, there is a big mango tree in Belur Mutt. Even now it is there. Swami Vivekananda used to sit under that mango tree and would speak with his Western disciples. They would all sit on chairs, so he would also sit. They would take some tea and then Swamiji would talk for hours together about India and Indian culture. So that big mango tree is there even now. So sitting under the tree, one day Swami Vivekananda told to Swami Shivananda, "The power of this place, that means the Belur Mutt, will continue for centuries. Sri Ramakrishna and Holy Mother are guiding this order." So Swami Vivekananda told at that time, everybody feels now the same thing. How this order is going on? So many troubles came. At that time, the whole India was under the British supremacy. British government was there. They were not at all willing to allow the Indians to come up. They would put brake for every progress in Indian society. So they created lot of problems for all the institutions, including ours also. In spite of all that one, because of Sri Ramakrishna and Holy Mother's power, this order went on growing. And Varanasi Advaita Ashrama was established in 1902. That was just before Swami Vivekananda passed away. Actually, when the Varanasi Advaita Ashrama was inaugurated, it was July 4th. On that very day, Swami Vivekananda left this mortal coil in Mahasamadhi. So, Swami Shivananji continued to nurture that Advaita Ashrama in Varanasi for 7 years. And then, one devotee came to him in Banaras and told him, "You see, I have committed so many sins, sir. So how can I be relieved from this one?" So, and he shed tears of repentance. Immediately, Swami Shivananda told him, "Sri Ramakrishna has said, the tears that are shed in repentance and in love of God are like the fire for all the sins. If you repent by shedding tears and pray to God, you see, I have done mistake. please wash these mistakes, wash these sins off me. Then they act like fire for all the sins. All sins will be burnt away. They act like fire to the cotton bales. Grace of Lord is like a spark enough to burn down the whole hillock of bales of cotton. So how one spark is enough to burn all the cotton. So the name of God burns all one's sins away. Pray to God, repeat His name. This is what the advice He gave. That applies to all of us also. So many psychoanalytic patients are there. So they think that they have committed something wrong. So their mind does not work properly. They become psychological patients. So if they have got some faith, they can take the name of God with faith, they can feel themselves completely free from all the sense of guilt and become as normal as anybody else. Why? They can become super normal also. So once when he was at Ranchi, some devotees came and complained to him, "Sir, we are unlucky, we could not see Sri Ramakrishna." Then Swami Shivananda told them, "Why you are seeing us? He who sees the Son sees the Father. So we are His children. When you see us, in one way you are seeing Sri Ramakrishna. So we have seen Sri Ramakrishna, we have seen God Himself. He is also Son of God. We are also sons of Sri Ramakrishna. You have seen us." So in 1921, again he came to Madras, Chennai. He came along with Swami Brahmanandaji to inaugurate our student's home here in Chennai, Mylapore. Then he went to Mysore also. Mysore, he visited the Chamundi temple on the hillock. When he went there, he says, "I saw living mother there. I had a vision of living Chamundi there." We had the vision of Chamundi. Then he goes to the place, the Melkote, where Ramanuja lived for 14 years. So he went to that sacred pilgrimage also. Then afterwards, in 1922, he went to East Bengal, the present-day Bangladesh, to Dhaka. Then there all people came, for hundreds of people, for initiation into mantra. Give us Diksha. In hundreds they came. He said, "No, I will not initiate." He refused to initiate. Perhaps at that time Swami Brahmananji was the president. So it was a custom only the president will initiate. So perhaps keeping that in mind, "I have not taken permission from Brahmananji, so I will not initiate." He refused. On the night, Holy Mother appeared in his dream and then said, "If you do not initiate, who else will initiate them? Who will go to Bangladesh all the way? You are already there and you are a child of Sri Ramakrishna and you have all the capacity and power to initiate people and raise them up. So if you don't initiate, who will initiate?" When Mother appeared in a dream and told, he said, "I have received order from Holy Mother. Therefore, I have to initiate." Then he started initiating. So once Swami Shivananji, in Dakshineshwar, Sri Ramakrishna, he reminisces about his days with Sri Ramakrishna. In Dakshineshwar, Sri Ramakrishna told me, "Swami Vivekananda, Brahmananda, yourself, all of you have to initiate many people in future as I am doing now." So Sri Ramakrishna has predicted then itself. He had told Holy Mother already, "What have I done? You have to do much more." So he has told the disciples also, "You will have to initiate like me in future." At that time they were all youngsters undergoing training. How they all, each one became a giant, spiritual giant, and started initiating so many hundreds of people. In 1922, Swami Brahmananji took ill and in cholera. Then he gave up his body in Mahasamadhi. Then when he was suffering from cholera, Swami Shivananji was so much moved. He loved Swami Brahmananji so much. So he prayed to Sri Ramakrishna, "You please take my life away in his place. So let him live. Let Raja live. In his place, you take me away. But Sri Ramakrishna appeared 3 times before him. 3 times he prayed, you leave Swami Brahmananji and take me away in his place. He did not listen to him at all. Without talking, he disappeared. And then afterwards, Swami Brahmananji passed away in Mahasamadhi. Once in Belur Math, it was the eve of Swami Sri Ramakrishna's birthday. Then he started pouring and pouring. In Belur Math there was no place, shelter, under which you can feed thousands of people who come for prasad. So on the birthday of Sri Ramakrishna, thousands of people have come, and it has started raining. Then they went and told, what shall we do? Thousands of people are there, where will they stand? How will the prasad be served? Then Mahapurush Maharaj came out of his room, looked at the sky and prayed to Sri Ramakrishna and went away. After some time, the whole thing became clear. The rain stopped, everything became clear, and thousands of people took their prasad and went away. Then in 1924, he again comes to Chennai, and this time from Chennai to Kunur and Ooty he went. In Ooty he was staying with a devotee's house. And this devotee, early morning he was sitting along with other swamis. Other swamis from Chennai also had come, and maybe from other swamis from Bangalore had come. So along with other 6-7 swamis, Mahapurush Maharaj also sitting in the early morning. Maybe there was sunlight in the morning, winter time, they were all sitting. One dhobi, washerman, so he comes and then falls at the feet. Directly he goes to Mahapurush Maharaj. Among all the 7-8 swamis, how he identified Mahapurush Maharaj? He went and saluted Mahapurush Maharaj and then said, last night Mariamman came in my dream. She came and told, there is a great man who has come. He is there at Booty. In the morning you go and see. And she showed you. That is how I could recognize you as soon as I see. She has asked me, I have got a number of acres of tea estate here. 2 acres of tea estate, I want to give it to you. Then Mahapurush Maharaj said, you see, last evening when we were walking, going on a walk, I found on my right side a large tea estate. So a thought came into my mind, if an ashrama can be started here, it would be very good. Just a thought came to me. I didn't tell it to anybody also. He has thought and he has come back. In the very night, mother has appeared to the dhobi, owner of that land. He comes automatically himself and then hands over that 2 acres of land. Of course, we have added some more there. We have got the beautiful ashrama in Ooty now. So, how Sri Ramakrishna works through all these great people. Similarly, in 1925, he comes back to Chennai. From here, he travels to Bombay. On the way to Bombay comes this Kadapa, recently where we have opened a center 5 years back. This Kadapa is one of the poorest districts of Andhra Pradesh. When the famine would come there, the people would be so poor, they would eat grass directly, just like cows. They would survive on grass for months together during the famine period. Pandit Nehru had come once and shed tears. I have never seen, I have heard. So much of poverty is there in this country. In 1956, we did our first relief work there in Kadapa. So at that time, in 1985, there was a Ramakrishna Seva Samaj there. How they formed a Ramakrishna Seva Samaj in 1925? So there was a small institution, and there was one Muslim called Khan Bahadur Manjumia. Manjumia was a Yunani doctor, and he was a Sufi Muslim, very good, well, good-hearted person. Somehow he felt that Sri Ramakrishna is Muhammad himself who has come in that form. So in the Ramakrishna Seva Samaj, he had helped the Ramakrishna Seva Samaj, and he had given away his property to that Ramakrishna Seva Samaj. And they were running a small ashrama. There was a shrine where the picture of Sri Ramakrishna was there, even though it is there. There this Muslim used to go daily and sit and meditate sitting in a corner. And when Mahapurush Maharaj went to Kadapa, that Ramakrishna Seva Samaj, they invited him, "Sir, you have come here, you must bless our institute and go." So he went to bless their institution, stayed there for 2 nights. So early morning when he sees this Manjumiya is meditating, 2 days, morning, first day, second day. Then Mahapurush Maharaj is a Sarvajna, he knows everything. He told others, "You see, he is thinking of Sri Ramakrishna as Muhammad come down in that form. That is why he is meditating on Sri Ramakrishna. He is a great devotee." So he has praised. So that was recorded, so that it is printed also. That is how this legend came down to us. So a Muslim donating that, later on when he passed away, that property was lying in the hands of the Ramakrishna Samaj. Then they handed over it to us. Then afterwards from there, we have developed it further, taking out Anath, taking some more land and building up a big center there. So this Khan Bahadur Manjumiya, how he became devoted to Sri Ramakrishna? Nobody went and preached to him. He became such a great devotee. So first convention, the All India Convention of all the monks and devotees was done in 1926. This is the first convention of the Ramakrishna order. Ramakrishna order does not consist of only monks. According to Swami Vivekananda, Ramakrishna mission will have members from both monks and householders. Both together we have to work for the welfare of the human society. First to start with the Indian society, then through this Indian society to influence the whole world, whole human society is to be brought up in the spiritual sphere. That was the plan of Swami Vivekananda. So when it was formed in 19, and the first meeting, that means 1897 it was formed. So almost about 30 years, 1897 to 1926, the first convention of the Ramakrishna order. All the devotees and the sannyasins, they all met in Belur Mutt. That was the first one. The second one to take place, it took 54 years. First after 30 years of starting, it was done. Then we could not hold it again. In 1980, the second convention was held. The third one, when it will be held, we do not know. Already 30 years are passed, from 80 to 1910. Everybody is asking, when will be the next third convention? So in the first convention, Mahapurush Maharaj was the president. He was just like a small child. He was very happy that all the devotees and sannyasins have come. Why did they come together? They wanted to compare notes. For 30 years we have worked. In what direction are we going? In what direction Sri Ramakrishna, Holy Mother and Swamiji wanted us to go? Are we going in the right direction? If not, why? If we have progressed, so why not we increase that progress by improving our work? So to discuss all these things and become wise from what we have done and what we have not done, this convention was called. Then it is to be presided over by Swami Shivanandaji, and he has to deliver the presidential address. He said, "I cannot deliver an address in English." So he asked Swami Nikhilanandaji, young Swami from America. So he asked, "All right, you write a speech for me." Then he said, "All right, Maharaj, you order me, I will write it with you." He thought that when he writes the speech, then it will be taken by Shivanandaji and he will read. So when the speech was all ready and Mahapurush Maharaj has to deliver the presidential address, he called Nikhilanandaji, "You yourself read this speech." So he is himself read. He himself has written, of course, on the order of Shivanandaji. So he started reading. Yes, Mahapurush Maharaj has asked me to read his speech. So he announced like that and he started reading. When he is reading and when some good passages are there, immediately Mahapurush Maharaj is remarking from the rostrum, from the pedestal, he is telling, "Oh, the boy has written it very well." That means, showing, "I have not written that. It is his own speech." So the whole audience, they were all very much amused. It was so simple. So he asked him to write, asked him to read, and then acknowledges before everybody, it is he who has written that. On my behalf, he himself has done. He was so open, so transparent. You cannot expect anybody to be more transparent than that. So it was at that time, he declared that Math and Mission in the body of Sri Ramakrishna. He presided over the meeting. I clearly see, he said to the assembled devotees and sannyasins, I clearly see that Sri Ramakrishna and all other direct disciples are helping us from behind. None can stop this progress. Satyameva Jayate, truth will always triumph. And that's what happened. So many difficulties came in the name of the British people. How much difficulty they gave, but the mission marched on. When he was staying in Ooty, he tells about his experience in Ooty. He spent several months in Ooty. He says a luminous person emanates. He is sitting in the morning with open eyes. He sees a luminous person emanates, pervades the whole universe, and he finds that infinite person is Sri Ramakrishna himself. He finds Sri Ramakrishna enveloping the whole universe in a big vision when he was in Ooty. Similarly, many people come to meet him when he was in Ooty, Muslims, Hindus, from different religions. So he told about one Muslim lady. She came and then met him and talked to him and went away. He told others, this lady is worshipping Krishna. She has had visions of Krishna. She is a Muslim lady, but she is devoted to Krishna. So Krishna is giving her visions also. That's what she wanted to verify with me. Come and told me about that. So in 1927, at Varanasi, so he saw Shiva himself, Vishwanatha, with matted hair. Then afterwards, Vishwanatha changed into Sri Ramakrishna. So then Mahapurush Maharaj told others, here in Varanasi, Sri Ramakrishna is living in Vishwanatha himself. So when you go and salute Vishwanatha, you are saluting Sri Ramakrishna also. He is Lord Vishwanatha here. And we find in Turiyananji's life, Turiyananji was going to visit Jagannath temple. So when he goes, he is going up and Sri Ramakrishna is coming down the stairs. They met in between. Then Turiyananji saluted him. Sri Ramakrishna was no more in the physical body. Turiyananji's vision was so clear, he forgot that Sri Ramakrishna is in the physical body. So clear is the vision. So he fell at his feet, and when he got up, then Sri Ramakrishna has vanished. Then Turiyananji remarked, here in Puri, Sri Ramakrishna has become Jagannatha. He is Jagannatha in Puri, he is Vishwanatha in Varanasi, because it is only one Paramatma only. He has taken so many forms, so in all these forms, he alone is there. Then in 1929, he relaid the foundation stone of the Belur Math temple. There was some problem in the earlier foundation stone. Therefore, it was changed over to the present state. So he laid the foundation stone. And afterwards he said, I have realized the infinite. And he told another Swami, you read our lives, they are like Upanishads. What are these Upanishads? Upanishads are nothing but the experiences of the great rishis. When we read the Upanishads, we read the narration by Yajnavalkya, by Vamana Rishi, Vishwamitra Rishi, all these rishis, they tell their experiences. That is what the Upanishads are, spiritual, direct experience of God by the great ones. So that the same thing is there with all the direct disciples. Their direct experience of God is there. So that is why Mahapurush Maharaj says, along with the Upanishads, if you read our lives, they are also Upanishads. Belur Math. So regarding Belur Math, one day he was in Belur Math, and then suddenly he found that somebody may be waiting for him. He told his attendant, go and see if there anybody is waiting for initiation. No, sir, there was nobody. No, no, you go and see. Now somebody must have come. So when he comes and sees, there was one lady waiting. Then he went and asked, why have you come here? Then she told, you see, I have committed so many bad deeds. I am so much repentant. I am full of sorrow. I want to get out of this sorrow. I want to get initiated by Mahapurush Maharaj. So this brahmachari or young swami went and reported to Mahapurush Maharaj. She is, one lady is waiting, but she has told about herself like this. Then Swami Shivananji did not say anything. Bring her here. Then this lady went and he told her, offer all your sins at the Sri Ramakrishna's feet. Say, I shall sin no more. And she became completely free from all her sins. Immediately she comes out with a light heart, with a smiling face, she returns. So that is how he used to say, the name of God washes away all the blemishes in our mind, in our body. Then later on, in the last days of his life in Belurmath, he became such an ocean of compassion. There was no question of his compassion, no limit to it. Everybody got his compassion. One cobbler used to come. So there was a particular charge. If he repairs one shoe, he must be given this much. So all the swamis, brahmacharis, they would get their repair every day done. Depending upon the number of shoes or chappals he has repaired, he used to be paid. Then Mahapurush Maharaj used to say, why do you calculate? Give him 10 rupees like that. In those times, to give 10 rupees means it was almost 1,000 rupees now. So give him 10 rupees, what is there? So for cobbler, so he was so compassionate. Fishermen and fisherwomen would come with fresh fishes, just like vegetables. So when they would come, the swamis will higgle haggle with them regarding the price. So they tell, so some price they wanted to bring it down. Then Mahapurush Maharaj would come. Early morning they have come just to make some money. And why are you just arguing with them? Whatever they ask, you give. So whatever they ask, he used to get them paid. They would go away. One fellow, Miss MacLeod, a visitor from America, she was staying in Belurmath. One fellow got into her room and stole away many things. And somehow or other he was caught, that thief. They brought him to Mahapurush Maharaj. Mahapurush Maharaj asked, what is the matter? He has stolen away so many things from Miss MacLeod's room. Then he just looked at him and with great compassion, and then he said, you see, poor man, he must be in need of so many things. So he found it there in our place. He has taken away. What could he do? So leave him away. Simply he was left without any punishment, without any warning. He was so full of compassion, nobody could do anything. So he went away and he told Miss MacLeod, you see, he has taken away your things and I left him off. So Miss MacLeod also appreciated the greatness of this Swami. He is full of compassion. What can be done? So that means he did not see a thief in a thief. He sees just like any one of us. He is also there. The only outer show only. Like in a drama, somebody comes in the form of a thief, somebody comes in form of a saint. Neither is saint is a saint nor thief is a thief. They are what they are. This is how he must have seen the different persons. So looking at his photo one day, there are number of photos of Mahapurush Maharaj available. So one photo, Mahapurush Maharaj is sitting with Swami Vivekananji, Swami Brahmananji, Swami Premananji. This is at the very room, the entrance to the room of Swami Vivekananda in Belurmath. This is one of the very beautiful photos. Swamiji is squatting on a big bench. So all these people are sitting around. Swami Brahmananji sitting on one side. Behind him, Turiyananji is there. Swami Premananji is there. So Swami Shivananji looks at this photo and then looks and says, oh, here is Swami Vivekananda, here is Swami Brahmananda, here is Premananda, all great people. But who is this rogue who is sitting by his side? About himself, he is telling, who is this rogue who has joined this company? Yes, he has become a saint being in the company of saints. This fellow is a rogue. He has become a saint, being in the company of saints like Vivekananda, Brahmananda, Premananda. So much was his humility. And Sri Ramakrishna had made him an Ishwar Koti. He used to tell about himself. Ishwar Koti, Sri Ramakrishna used to count 5. Swami Brahmanandaji, Swami Vivekananda, Swami Niranjananandaji, Premanandaji and Yoganandaji. These 5 were called Ishwar Koti, special messengers of God. They are born pure persons, highly born with high spiritual power. His name was not there. So Sri Ram, he says, I have also been made a Ishwar Koti by Sri Ramakrishna. What he meant by that, nobody knows. But this fact is there. He has himself announced, Sri Ramakrishna has made an Ishwar Koti. Then he tells the power that Sri Ramakrishna can give to anybody. Mango tree, that mango tree that is there, he shows a mango tree in the Belur Math and says, if I tell it, you attain mukti, now itself will attain mukti. According to the Shastra, a mango tree has to become a living being. From living being it has to grow and then it becomes a man. After 80 lakhs of births only it can become a man. Then after only it can expect any moksha. Mahapurusha Maharaj says, if I tell that mango tree, you attain mukti, immediately it will attain mukti. So much power Thakur has given by his grace. So much of power is in all of us. But he will not allow us to do all these things. According to his will only it can work. But we know that he has endowed us all with so much power. Sri Ramakrishna himself is in Belur Math because Swami Vivekananda has brought him and installed him there. Swami Vivekananda has installed him in Belur Math, so Sri Ramakrishna himself is in Belur Math. Sri Ramakrishna himself is in his picture. He listens to your prayers. Ramakrishna's name is the Taraka Mantra for this age. So in 1932, one Dhan Gopal Mukherjee, his disciple, he wrote a book called Face of Silence. Swami Shivananda said, Sri Ramakrishna has not gone away. Sri Ramakrishna is here. Even when Buddha passed away also, all people burst into tears. But Buddha told them, no, I am not going anywhere. I am going to be with you eternally. Similarly, Sri Ramakrishna also is eternally with us. He has not gone anywhere. So he has told that Dhan Gopal Mukherjee, he wrote this one. And so many Westerners were influenced by that book, The Face of Silence of Dhan Gopal Mukherjee. Then one day, Shivananji had the vision of Sri Ramakrishna. Swami Brahmananji, Swami Vivekananda, they all came and told, Tarakda, come, let us go. So he is in the last days of his life in Belur Math. So Swami Brahmananji, Vivekananda, they all left the body earlier. They were all coming and telling, Tarakda, let us go, come, you also. In 1933, April, after initiation of several devotees, he got a paralytic attack. And his right side was paralyzed. He could not speak very clearly. He continued for 10 months like that. But he would go on blessing and smiling at everybody. His memory was perfect. One of our Swamis, who had gone to him as a young man from Malda, so he went to him and saw he could not speak. Then he thought at this state, his mind also would be completely in confusion. He may not be able to remember me. Some years back he has come to Shivananji. As soon as he went and stood before him and thought that he may not be able to recognize me, some years back I had come to him, immediately Maharaj, in his own difficult speaking mode, he said, Malda, Malda, Malda. That means he has come from Malda. But memory was perfect. Only outside it was a paralytic attack, but inside he was alert. and alive to everything. So he continued for 9 months. In February 34, third Sunday, so he had some asthma, blood pressure, pneumonia together. Yet he beamed with joy. His hairs on whole body and head stood on end out of joy, and he left the body in Mahasamadhi. So that is why he, in Belur Math, when Mahapurush Maharaj is there, his picture is there, just like Swami Vivekananda's temple is there, Holy Mother temple is there, Brahmananji's temple, Swami Shivananji's one special room is there, the old temple. There, his picture is kept. If one looks at it, one feels as if he is living there. So he is as if blessing everyone, sitting there for all time to come. So he says that Swami Vivekananda is the Jagadguru, Sri Ramakrishna is the Avatar Varishta, Holy Mother is the Divine Mother. So surrender yourself to him. You don't have to worry for anything. Everything will be taken care of them. So Swami Shivananji's life is a glorious life. It is so simple. And when we read his life, everything about spiritual life, he speaks in such a common way. To get one experience of that one, perhaps all our life we will have to struggle. But hundreds of experiences he goes on telling. It happened like that, it happened like that, it happened like that. That is how these great people's life, when we read, we feel that spiritual life is a very, very natural one. It can come to every one of us. When we see the masters, we feel we can also follow them. We can also benefit by following them. That is why they come. So Swami Shivananji was a special disciple of Sri Ramakrishna, whose life has influenced thousands and thousands of people, hundreds of swamis, thousands and thousands of householders. All have got spiritual light from him, and he continues to inspire. And he is a Mahapurusha by the words of Swami Vivekananda himself. And such a great person's birthday we observe today, and we were very fortunate. By the grace of Sri Ramakrishna, we could reminisce some of the great incidents in his life. Let us pray to Sri Ramakrishna, Holy Mother, Swamiji, and Swami Shivanandaji, that they bless us all for our worldly life, success in our worldly life, and success in our spiritual life also.
Niranjanam nityamanantarupam bhaktanukampadhrita vigraham vai ishavataram parameshamidyam tam ramakrishnam shirasa namamah.